My name's Scott Koch. I'm a mycologist, and that's just a fancy word for somebody who studies mushrooms and other things in the fungal world. And I own a company called the Telluride Mushroom Company. I've been involved with growing mushrooms, installing mushrooms on people's landscapes, wild harvesting mushrooms, presenting to the state. If you read my bio, it's kind of got a lot of information, but I've just been in some pretty good situations where I've known the right people at the right times and had a foot in the door, and it's kind of led me in the direction of my passion. And a few years ago, I came back from Honduras, 7 years ago, and I just said, you know, I want to know how I can live a life with fungi and make that my focus. Instead of chasing jobs and, you know, doing a little odd construction job here, fix it up job there, you know, but that still happens, so. Basically, it has taken me there. You know, I directed the Telluride Mushroom Festival for a couple years and brought a new perspective to it that hadn't ever been looked at, cultivation on a deeper end, bringing in micro-remediation practices. And, you know, some of those topics are very familiar to people, or maybe medicinal topics are familiar to people, or psychedelics are topics that really get you going or whatever. But understanding that mushrooms are in our life and are pretty much the foundation of everything around us changes the perspective. And when Travis was actually going to do the presentation here, and he said, hey, would you mind doing it? I'm kind of stepping out of that realm, you know, I'm working with soils. And I was like, but that's like right up your alley. You are in on this thing, you know. And he and I have been working off and on together for a few years now. And I said, sure. I came over and met Debbie and Gary, and they talked about right relationship. And I was like, this is exactly what it's about. It's understanding comes from a lifelong learning. It comes from experience. It comes from taking time to understand and try to feel what's going on. And with mushrooms, I come from an ecological viewpoint, so the relationships are just so important. And talking to Gary was not just amusing, it was enlightening in some way. So this is, you're going to see some pictures of this stuff. This is a project that I did. It's a micro roof. It's on top of the Pandora water treatment plant in Telluride. It's the highest big project going on in mycology. It's a test plot. It's 35, I've got a 7,000 square foot space on top of the roof. It's not easy to get to. There's a lot of problems with like how it went down to make it happen, but I was approached on a really cold October day. They said, come on out, let's go. You know, you want to grow mushrooms up here? And I was like, I'd love to. And I went and brought all my stuff, my little, you know, instruments for measuring temperature and all that stuff. And normally I like to take a soil temperature, and I went to go stick the thermometer in the ground, and it just solid. It's like, I can't grow mushrooms. I'll do the temperature right here on the surface. So I laid the thing out, said 40 degrees. I was like, you can't get my ceiling to grow at 40 degrees. Like, you can't get it to expand. It needs to meet a certain condition. We need to like prepare it for that, you know, that's our job. So one side's a control, which is just their mix, and then my side has mushroom mix plus their mix, and we'll talk more about that in a minute. Cool. I believe that really like the fundamental idea behind mushrooms as a medicine for the earth or the medicine for the people is that we need to use it on ourselves first. We need to understand how mushrooms can be used and then use them. Whether it's psychedelics for you, or whether it's making a tincture out of reishi, or powdering things up and using it in your food, or going out and wild harvesting these things, we need to know how it works with us. And then we need to know our relationship to that. And then from there, we can prescribe it to our landscape. So I wouldn't be doing this if I didn't feel confident in my relationship with this organism, and with the idea that mushrooms can and do, their natural role is to build nutrients, to break down things and make soils and help prepare other things in the system for having food and nutrients and soils that they can build a good, strong foundation off of. And we're talking plants, we're talking bacteria, we're talking viruses, we're talking everything. These things are amazing what they do. So we must begin to heal ourselves in order to begin healing our environment. You know, that's, we as a community of people with a good intention, and these are the right people, you know, we are the right people. We're the ones that are going to make this happen. So today we're going to study this and understand this a little bit here. Then with this foundation of knowledge, I don't know if you've seen it. I was out watering last night and at midnight to get all the stuff prepped for today so that we can do a mushroom installation. So you can actually see what we're going to talk about in action and move from there. That way it's experiential education. All right. So bump backs, you can hit it one more time and it'll bounce a little thing in there for us. Fungi, that's the classification. So go back to your science class. You learned about five kingdoms of science, right? That's like plants and animals and bacteria. We'll see a slide about that. Fungi are just one of those. It branched off and animals came off of the fungal branch. So it might give you some insight into how some of the mushroom medicine works, since we are related to the fungi, if you go way back, right? 1.5 million estimated species. This is an estimate, okay? Nobody really knows how many there are. It's just estimated. It's extrapolated from numbers. This is the science component of it, right? Number of described species, 70,000 species. Some people say it's 45,000. Well, that's empirical evidence, okay? You can see it. It's written out. It says that there's a Boletus rubriceps in Colorado. There's a Tremes versicolor that occurs across the whole world. You know, like, it's provable, that one. And the last one is the largest known living organism on the planet is this that we know of, that we can describe and that we've, you know, figured it out. Armillaria stoia. This is the honey mushroom. It's a delicious mushroom, but you don't want to cultivate it, because then you're responsible for what happens around your neighborhood, right? And this one is estimated at 2,200 acres and 2,400 years old. I don't think you want to deal with a problem that size. So when we're talking about micro-remediation, the effects things have on other things, we need to know that stuff. And I don't think we're yet prepared for some of the micro-remediation issues that evolve. All right. So here's a brief description of some of those six kingdoms, the eubacteria, the archaebacteria, the protistae, the plants, the fungi, and the animals. You know, one of the things that's highly overlooked and people don't realize is that our desert landscapes in the Southwest, our alpine landscapes throughout the world, are very unique, and people come from temperate environments. They come from places where there's lots of water. The population of the United States, or anywhere else in the world, revolves around water. That is an area that is temperate or has a completely different architecture than the architecture we have in our soils here. And when they write these mushroom books, the mushroom books are written from the Pacific Northwest. That's not here. We have a few books for the Rocky Mountains in the Southwest and whatever, and those things don't talk about one crucial aspect. What does your footprint do when you step on that soil? What does your foot do when you step on a desert soil? It erodes it immediately, okay? That's the answer. If you're walking on sandstone, you're walking on lichens, the foundational component that breaks things down, these pioneer species that help build soil. And a lichen is a relationship between cyanobacteria and a basidiomycete mushroom and you know, a couple other things. They're finding out more and more and more. Well, those five kingdoms of science, I don't know if you realize, this is six kingdoms up here. Some people estimate that there's more than that in science. And this archaeobacteria, the biological crust, is probably the least understood component. But out here, everybody knows it. They've been to a national park that says, don't crush the crypto, right? True. Don't crush the crypto. Why? Because it could take 50 to 2,000 years for that to grow just this much. And one step ruins it. Well, what? It doesn't just ruin that. It ruins the whole architecture for how you build the next soil layer on top of it. If you go up high, where people love to go pick wild mushrooms, right now is not a good time because it's dry and crunchy and every footstep crushes stuff, whether you see it or not. So there's, you go up and pick chanterelles. Chanterelles have a relationship, a mycorrhizal relationship. Its roots and the roots of the spruces and firs and things around it are related. And the root system of the fungi are delivering nutrients into the root tips of the trees and plants that it's associated with. And the chanterelle has a slow-growing mycelium. It grows right underneath a layer of mosses in that area. That's kind of, the mosses act as the mulch. They're holding in a little bit more moisture. The soils are a little bit more rich and moist in that spot. And this layer of mycelium is growing out under there, right? And when you step on it when it's dry, and when you're wearing hiking boots, which everybody says you should be wearing hiking boots to protect your ankles, well, what about protecting the forest ecosystem? I see people here who are barefoot. Yes, I love that. People wearing sandals. Yes, I love that. People who are wearing tennis shoes. I love that. That is soft and friendly on the forest floor, right? So biological crusts are a very important builder. They connect the tree, you know, when you walk through the forest at 10,000 feet, let's say. There's a tree here, tall skinny tree, right, some alpine trees. Another tree here, and there's a big gap in between. And sometimes you see soil, sometimes you see clumps of grass, sometimes you see just blank areas, sometimes you see a nice, lush, mossy kind of matrix of mosses and lichens and plants and things. And those places that have that buildup have spent thousands of years building soils in that area, or hundreds of years since the last forestry operation was there, right? And so what we're trying to do is we're trying to mimic what's going on in a desert area. When we disturb soils like this, we protect them with that excelsior cloth on top, or we put mulches on top, so that that soil layer starts to build back those layers of relationships. And we're not, when we're growing a mushroom, we're not just growing one mushroom. We are growing a whole host of fungi that are in the soil, from things that aren't going to fruit and make a little mushroom on top, to little yeasts and things that are included with most of the wood chips, or that are growing on the surface of things, like juniper berries have that nice little powdery yeast on the outside of them, right? You can make, you guys will just throw it out there, you can make your own bread from that yeast, okay? You can make your own fermented things from that yeast. And natural fermentation, when people do that, that's coming from the air. That's bringing in yeast from the air and from the surface of the fruits that you're harvesting. So these are fungi. These are the things that make your cheeses, your milk, your breads, your other fermented vegetables. So it's the basis for a lot of the things we enjoy and for the health that comes from that. All right. Life cycle of mushroom. Okay, mushroom. Let's not just say it's a mushroom, because there's a lot of things that don't look like that one right there, okay? That's the iconic shape of a mushroom. So you see that iconic mushroom. Underneath it has some gills, and you look at those gills, those little plates. You go to a grocery store and you buy like a portobello, right? And that portobello has that little cap and those dark gill plates under there that are thin, look like a sheet of paper with spores on them. Those spores get ejected out of that mushroom. That mushroom is called a basidiomycete. It has a spore-producing mechanism that comes up and has these four little things that shoot out spores out of the top. There are other ones like morels that have a spore-producing mechanism that looks like a finger loaded like one of those you know, firework things that you shoot like little balls at people and stuff. I guess you're not supposed to do that. They shoot out the top too. All right, so that spore would be similar to like a seed from a plant, and then that spore goes into its environment when it finds the right situation, moisture and more moisture, and we're in the desert, so it needs just the right host of things here. It gets, starts to grow. It sends out these little hairs, and these little hairs down there where it says the spore germination, okay? The spore germination is when you start to see this hyphal structure. This is the very first, like, people would say it's mycelium, but it's not mycelium until two of those cross, create an elbow clamp connection, and then grow from there. And now you have all of the genetic information. Until then, you only had half of the genetic information. So it wasn't going to reproduce at all. But it would still grow in its environment, would still be a beneficial piece of the environment and component of soil building. So you take this germinating spore, it's growing out, hyphal connection, whoop, and all of a sudden you have mycelium and it can just take off and run and do what it does. The mycelium grows out, and when it gets to, like, it's eating things, okay? So these things are eating cellulose and lignin. We're going to talk a little bit more about that and what those roles entail. But it eats that stuff. It breaks it down. It's creating nutrients in the environment. It gets enough energy. The growing parameters change enough that you have, like, the right amount of sugars and things that it's eaten and cellulose that it's broken down and released carbon and things. And then it goes into pinning fruit, like just the baby mushrooms, and that's called primordia, where it starts to come together and create like a mass that starts to draw in all this energy from its broader area, and then pins these little tiny miniature mushrooms, and then adds more moisture. Like if you have a chanterelle, it takes a long time for the development. It takes 3 weeks or so for something like that to just develop from primordia. But let's say you get a big, heavy rain, right? And a mushroom, let's say it's 90% water. If you got a mushroom that's this big, that's like more than a pint of water that needs to get absorbed to build that mushroom. So if you get a little rain in the afternoon, that's not going to do it. You need a lot of water. That's when monsoon comes in and the mushrooms start pumping. And that's when the ground is not crackly and fragile. That's when the ground is soft and you can't hear your friends walking on the ground. And you feel that in your skin and you feel it around you, right? And you gotta pick up a little stick and it doesn't break, it bends. That's when it's mushroom season. That's when you see these mature, big mushrooms coming out of the ground. Right now, you could spend hours walking around just to find one mushroom. You'd be like, yeah! And then you'd go home and you'd cut it open and it's full of worms. Because they're eating it too. All right, let's check something out. So, three types of fungi. There's saprobes. They basically break things down so that they start like this nutrient system. Then you have the mycorrhizae, which are related to the other plants around them. They've got root associations. And they uptake the nutrients. They do a little bit of breakdown of things, but they kind of take up the nutrients and deliver it in there like an IV to the plants. And then you have the parasites, and this is the circle. The parasites drop the trees. They kill the trees. The honey mushroom kills the trees. And then those trees hit the ground, and then you have another mushroom that starts to decompose it and break it down, because there's really nothing that breaks down cellulose so that something else can eat it. So let's imagine, we'll scale it up a little bit, all right, that this yurt is a cellulose molecule, okay? They're really big molecules. And when you get down to like the microscopic little bacteria and things out there, and you think that this is the biggest cookie you've ever seen in your life, right? And you are the size of a bacteria, and you decide, I'm going to try to take a bite out of this cookie. Is it going to work? No. you're not going to be able to eat this cookie. It's way too big. It's got all the energy you want. It's got everything you need. But you can't do anything about it. It's just sitting there. You're waiting for your friend, the fun guy, to show up and come in and start breaking it down. And he's dancing his butt off. You know, he's like breaking down the cellulose to create sugars and carbon. And there's these other minerals that are in there are unlocked. And now they're small enough for the bacteria to get in there and poop out some nitrogen and create all these good things that are in there. It takes either mechanical breakdown, which really only creates rough edges on these things, right? And doesn't really release a lot of the cellulose. If you take like a car tire over a patch of any kind of woody debris, it just breaks off a little bit of it. It doesn't break up all of the cellulose or the lignin, the heavy woody stem building material. So you need the saprobes to start working. And saprobes, I've got a list of saprobes we'll talk about in just a second, basically are just releasing those nutrients. They're super important. You need the most aggressive ones in the places that need it the most. Like here would be a great example. If you take something that takes a long time, it's not going to start releasing things and then making moisture like get absorbed through that system. You know, it's going to dry out if you don't choose something aggressive. Mycorrhizae are really cool. Imagine like an IV in your arm at the doctor's office, right? And it's just like full on pumping you with the best stuff you could ever want, right? That's what the mycorrhizae do. They anesthetize the roots of their host that they're going to live with, and these are symbiotic relationships. They come in and they uptake nutrients and moisture and all this stuff, and they deliver it right to the roots of the trees and the other plants that they're associated with. There's some estimations that without these relationships, the trees and plants you see probably wouldn't exist in a desert environment. They probably would have a much harder time getting the necessary nutrients because the climate isn't appropriate for it. But we have one of the best places to pick mushrooms in the world, right here in the La Platas, the San Juan Mountains, around us, because these relationships are there and they're healthy. And we need to maintain that from a management perspective. Like if you're in land management, if you're doing anything with the Forest Service or the Park Service or whatever, understanding those like relationships and maintaining those relationships are really important. Finding, if you go buy mushrooms from somebody, some people are not very good at picking mushrooms. They're damaging the environment when they're doing it. And you want to make sure that the person who's harvesting the mycorrhizal species, which are the boletes, which are the chanterelles, these are the mushrooms that everybody wants. They're the high dollar mushrooms. They're the ones that they put on the menus. Those are the mycorrhizal mushrooms. If you're over harvesting those, you might be damaging the forest ecosystem. If you're sustainably harvesting, taking a little bit here and there from each patch and allowing it to grow and get its spore dispersal and allowing mature things to fruit and stuff so you can get more genetic information in the environment, then you're actually harvesting within the boundaries of ecology, within the boundaries of this specific niche that these grow into. All right, let's go. So, common saprobes, the ones that break down cellulose, okay? You guys have heard of them. They grow them, and they're all anything that's being grown in a grow room environment is one of those things because they haven't figured out how to grow the ones that are in root associations. Those guys, me, anybody else who's experimenting with, like, throwing a mushroom into a pot and trying to grow it out with some stuff, we're figuring out that it's a long, hard road. So, oyster mushrooms, Stropharia, which we're going to use in the installation this afternoon, wood ear. I have some of these things that I had at the trade blanket last night. Some of them in powder form, some of them in like package form, and some of them are medicinals at the same time. So, the wood ears grow out of subalpine firs. The oyster mushrooms grow out of subalpine firs and aspens. You know, there's a few other things they might grow out of. The Enokitake is the velvet foot mushroom, grows out of aspens. The red belted polypore grows out of spruce trees. It's not a primary saprobe. So saprobes, break down things, right? Well, when you go see a freshly fallen tree, you're looking at a certain subsect of species that can actually go break that down at the beginning. After it's been run through by one species, that species takes off. Sometimes it sticks around for a while, but it takes off and something else comes in, a secondary or tertiary saprobe that breaks it down. Red belted polypore and artist palm, reishi, things like that, are all late stage saprobes. So when you run a log with one thing, you put this in after that, after like an oyster mushroom or stropharia, they love it to go for it right off the bat and break things down really fast. If you get that going, then it's gone, and then you put this in there, then it breaks it down. When you look into some of these trees that you can like kick open, stumps that you can just kick open, and they got these big conks on them, they're tertiary saprobes, or they're in there after other things have eaten it, and they're doing the last stage of breakdown so that there's even more residual minerals released for other things to eat. So, in your gardens around here, even in the hottest, driest desert, you've got your manure piles and whatever, and you see these little mushrooms that grow out of them with like little like half dome caps on them, and they're not big, they're maybe that big around, and they got a little slender stalk. This Pinellas semiovatus is something that grows in your garden. It grows right around the edges where the grasses come in on that area of manure or whatever. Sometimes it's right out in the middle of the field of manure and stuff, especially horse manure. Shiitake, a medicinal, is a saprobe. It breaks things down. In lion's mane, it's, of course, like it's growing on hardwoods. Like it's not something that's right here, but in the northwest, it's pretty common. All right. So what do they eat? This is a pretty long list of things. They eat cellulose and lignin. Right? That's really what we're talking about. They also like sugar. I mean, it doesn't everybody, right? Kind of get a little buzz. but what? Think about what a tree produces. What kind of byproducts of local industry can we utilize to reduce waste streams and to actually use waste streams in an appropriate fashion? So we're kind of linking everybody in the community together on products and projects and whatever else their philosophy entails. How can we do that? Like, that's really what this says right here, is what are we doing in our home life, and how can we utilize that at home to create soil, to grow food, to do all these good things. Really, the thing that's created from the breakdown of this material, right, is this gorgeous, material that's been broken down. It looks like dirt and wood chips and sticks and things, right? This is what a saprobe does. It turns it into something so gorgeous that you wish you had this in your garden every day, right? It's moist, it's rich, it's got mycelium in it, like little white things. This is what we're going to put into the ground in our installation because it's still alive. It's got a whole host of really good things in it. It's nummy. I've been growing this for 5 years. Yeah, that's
it. You made it.
I made this, yeah. I isolated this mushroom species and grew it out in my laboratory on plates and then dropped it onto some grains, some sterilized grains. Actually, this strain, when I did that, it's funny how certain things grow, you know, they sometimes don't want to be in a sterile environment, right? So you open the top so that it allows something in, you know, and then it takes off. This mushroom does that. It's funny to watch it when it finally figures out what's in there that's not sterile, when you like don't do it just enough so that there is something alive in there, so there's a potential for something alive, and then it discovers it, it grows out slow, finds it, and then pew, and sends like a lightning bolt down the side of the jar, and everything changes. It's so cool. That back picture in there is growing mushrooms on coffee grounds, a coffee shop up in Michigan where I was going to get coffee every day as I was kind of reacclimating to living in the United States after living abroad. Said, hey, would you want to grow mushrooms in here? I was like, I'd love to. Let's do it, you know. I don't like growing on coffee grounds, but it works. we didn't have anything else to mix because it was winter time, so we just grew it on coffee grounds and it worked. But you can use the byproducts of numerous industries. Your arborist friends, you know, people who have compost and whatever. Most people aren't going to give up their compost, but if you got a place like Excelsior, like Mancus does, you've got this huge amount of cellulose that you can use for building. You know, building soil is having this break it down. If you got a marijuana grow up, a hydro grow up near you, you got cocoa coir like crazy. If you got a coffee shop, you got this like nice fluffy material that the chafe off the beans makes it smell really good. But there's some of that in there already. That's how I grew it over the last couple weeks. And we're gonna dump some of that into our thing because it creates nitrogen really fast that is available for this to eat. Pretty cool. You can go to the free box in Telluride and get a whole bunch of old t-shirts and jeans and stuff and put all this stuff in there and roll it up and grow it out. You can have food coming straight out of clothes. Okay? You can go take a place like Telluride that is a box canning and everything comes in a box. That's why they call it a box canning. And everything has to leave. So let's eat that stuff there and reduce the carbon load in the mountains from the cars that are on the road and all that stuff, right? So, and a couple things have happened recently. You know, some guys out there found a plastic-eating mushroom. Doesn't surprise me because that's another one of these, like, carbon chain type things that it likes to break down, like motor oil and whatever. So, you know, there's a lot of things that can be. So keep that in mind. All right. So what do we got to do? We want to grow mushrooms in the desert, and that's what we're going to do this afternoon. We're going to take this stuff that's living material, we're going to move it into a new environment. It needs to like the environment. So last night I was watering the bed out here that we're going to do and all the materials, and at midnight, just to make sure that there was enough moisture locked into the system so when we go in today, we're not dropping it into a dry zone, you know? So you need to prep things so that there's enough moisture. That's looking at nature. Where do mushrooms grow? They grow in wet places. Where do mushrooms grow? They grow where there's lots of dead debris that's fallen off of trees and things. So, you know, what kind of food does it have? What does it eat? How does it go about doing that? And how do you maintain that moisture? Well, we talked about that this morning when you were talking, Greg. Mulch. Whether it's gravel mulch to hold in that moisture and reduce the amount of evaporative loss that comes in the desert from this wind that never ends. Or whether it's sun that's drying it out and heat that's drying it out, you gotta create an environment that holds that in. So you build deeper layers of mulch. Some estimates are that 18 inches is kind of the optimum deep layer that you can have to grow this stuff so that you don't lose that moisture. You dig down, you might have 4 inches or 6 inches or 8 inches of dry wood chips on top of it. At some point you're gonna run into moisture down in there. You're digging. You get to it and you're like, oh. And that's what the mushroom's doing too. It's like, I want to live there. I don't want to go up into that dry layer. I want to live down in the low spot. It's like the best spot. And they will move. If you bury a huge area of wood chips, they'll, like in deep wood chips, they'll go up and down and find the pockets of moisture. They'll move around until they got the optimum conditions. They'll, if it's in a landscape that's, excuse me, dry, it doesn't have any trees, it's going to look for that spot that's optimal, that little shaded spot where like just a little bit of a hill creates a little bit more shade on the north side on the hottest part of the day, you know? That temperature, that humidity, that's what it's looking for. It's looking for the most optimum conditions. They have a thermal tolerance. They can't take every bit of heat that comes at them. You know, if you're down in Phoenix and you're trying to grow on the surface in Phoenix, the surface of the ground, there's 160 degrees on a sunny, hot day in the summer, you know? It might even be hotter than that. Then nothing can live through that, not even your bare feet. So if your bare feet can tolerate it, then you probably can put some mushrooms in there.
Is Excelsior too fine?
Yeah, that's a good point. So Excelsior has a bunch of different types of mulches and their old rolls that they get rid of. there's inherent problems with things. Like if you have too much airflow, so like the loftiness of some of those rolls, those long strands of aspen, mm-hmm. really are a problem because it dries things out.
Right.
The structure of the mushroom mycelium has to grow a long distance and build rigid support to make those gaps. So you have to press it down with heavy weighted things to mm-hmm. make it ideal. I would use wood chips to do that,
right.
but it will eat the aspen. The fine aspen dust that they have it just creates moles because there's not enough oxygen. It locks in those things. There's no air. Creates just such an interesting situation. When I was digging through your ground, there was some of that in there, and I saw it, and I was like, oh, you know, this. It was all that stuff was moldy, and the stuff around it, the wood chips and everything, were white. So you want to kind of avoid it on a big scale, but you know, some of that's okay. Like I think if you take that powdery stuff. And do this to it and spend a little time with it, it fluffs it up, mix it in with the strong mulch that they have,
mm-hmm.
and then it becomes a usable architecture of materials.
Mm-hmm.
I would use wood chips if I can get wood chips,
right.
you know, and a good matrix of heavy, thick, long logs and things like that lets it run the distance and get in there and it protects it a little bit more. But you only need, you know, you need a little bit of those branches and things like that. The wood chips are, it's the best thing. It's like a little battery.
Are there any particular chips for wood chips that are not good?
Well, you wouldn't want to use fresh, like, pine wood chips because the sap in pines is designed as a fungicide. Even though it's sugary and we can taste that sugar in there when we taste it. It's designed to kill fungi, so it doesn't have those competitors. So you wouldn't want to use something that has that's a cedar or juniper kind of tree. Those are pretty much fungal resistant plants. And then pines are good. If you let the wood chips sit a little bit, those would be great. You do have to be careful if people apply the sides. Remember, who was that guy? Rich Miller? Is that his name? He was talking, he said the sides.
Mm-hmm.
The sides are problems. They're persistent chemicals sometimes.
Pesticides, fungicides, herbicides,
you know, things like that. So the sides, if you can get out of the sides, you're good.
So all this scrub oak is good?
Scrub oak's great. There's a lot of acids, though, in the leaves. So that can pose a problem when you're using the leaves as your mulch, but things will move out of the way, and some things will be able to eat if you let it sit a little bit. It helps. It needs to break down a little bit on the leaves, but as far as the wood is concerned, it's a good wood to use. If it's already been dead and standing, put it through a chipper, wet it up, get it going. If it's fresh, you gotta let it rest a little bit. Give it a couple months so it'll chill out so that the liquids in there won't be so toxic to the mushrooms. Let's move on to another. Alright, so the background photo is a landscape that I put in. It's in Placerville. I put in 60 cubic yards of aspen wood chips. I put in logs to terrace it out, and I've drilled those logs and put in dowels with myceliated types of dowels, but with different types of oyster mushrooms. And then I planted Stropharia in the open beds so it would run them out. And this is a remediation tactic. It was basically I had this hillside that had open slopes, south facing, so it's got the most sun exposure, the most wind exposure. It was an old driveway. The landlord said, hey, you guys aren't maintaining your lawn. And we were like, we can't even get soil to hang out. The slope is like running off the water. The water runs off the soil. We had just a couple clumps of grass growing in places. It just wasn't good. And you could tell that even with the irrigation they had on there, the tree needle length was like half the size it should be. And we were like, well, can we like do something here on the property? And they're like, yeah, go for it. Like, why would you ever want to put mushrooms? Well, because that's what I do. And so put it all in there, and you know, when the water first went in, when I started to water the bed, I'd pour water from the hose, just let it go through the wood chips, and I would dig out a hole downhill of it and watch the water run through and run down right underneath the wood chips. If I kept watering it, it would just run all the way down the street. We're losing water. We don't want that to happen. But within 2 weeks, the mycelium was locking it up, distributing it as soon as the water came in, and you didn't see it running underneath there anymore. It was like getting picked up and stuff like that. Within the first year, you could go dig out into the wood chips, and the roots of the trees were already growing up out of the hard, compacted soils. We applied a lot of dandelions to the landscape to kind of get deep rooted, get through the wood chips, and get down in to that dirt to start breaking it up. Just some power going on. And it started to loosen up the soils, and within 2 years, we had soils that weren't just completely compacted and dry and nasty looking, you know. After the first year, we went back and looked at the needle lengths, and the needle lengths had increased to like a healthy needle length. And we had pulled the irrigation off the trees as soon as we put the wood chips in. We got rid of the landscaping that they did and just went with the natural cycles of this. And the trees rebounded, the spruce bud worms left, the borers that were on some of the trees, not in high numbers, the trees were healthy. They had a response. Their immune response was, we're going to do it. We got enough moisture. We got some nutrients happening now, whatever. So you can do that with remediation. It's that simple, just to help the health of the tree. But let's say you use mushrooms to remediate an environmental problem, a toxic environmental problem. What happens when a animal eats the mycelium, like a little bug that worms love to eat mycelium? You know, beetles and ants and all kinds of little critters love to eat mycelium. What happens if they eat mycelium that's carrying heavy metals or toxins and things like that? Where do they go? Birds come in and eat them, and then what eats the birds, right? Other animals come in and eat mushrooms, right? And what eats those animals that we're hunting and gathering and doing the things that we do? So we gotta kind of weigh out what types of remediation we want to have. Not everything is actually doom and gloom in that situation. There's really fascinating things that happen in with mycelium locking up heavy metals so that they're no longer available in the environment. But how do you keep these toxins out of the food chain? That's kind of the biggest question. If you're going to remediate, you got to remediate with what's going to happen, and like Gary said, and like a lot of people said, 7 generations from now. You know? If we try to remediate our toxic environment. Well, maybe it's not in situ type of remediation in some situations. Maybe we have to have places where we do it all indoors so that we reduce that risk of contamination to the landscape, to the greater landscape. So, let's go to the next one. So this is that same landscape. This is all kinds of things. I'm utilizing multiple ways of growing fungi and utilizing landscape. So the top right photo there is an inset greenhouse that I built on top of an in-ground trampoline. And I found some materials in the backyard that the landlord didn't really care about. We asked, and he said he didn't know what it was, so we built a greenhouse. And a friend donated some greenhouse plastic and traded for some marijuana. And then we got a bunch of freebies from other places to get the shelves and the buckets and everything else we were growing with. Unique setting. After a cold snap in the winter, I mean, we got some really horrendous cold here, right? 20 below for a week. My water pipe's frozen just 40 feet from that. And I walked down in there. And as a byproduct of breakdown of cellulose, there's CO2. CO2 is heavier than air. It sits down in this space and it creates a nice warm layer. And there were reishi popping out of the floor that were 2 inches long. coming up to that spot, you can tell their tops are just starting to peel back this way. They've reached the top of the CO2 there that was in the floor, trapped in that inset thing. So the next thing that popped in my head was, how can I use fungi to heat a greenhouse so that I can have things growing year-round in this greenhouse? Like, that's a dream. It's a long ways away because I don't know how to do it yet. It definitely gave me some new answers. So working with fungi, the more you understand about what's going on, the greater the potential is to discover something pretty cool that works for you and can be transferred knowledge in other areas. So the center photo is Jafaria rugosa, and a lot of that's what we're going to plant out here. Very large body mushroom, super delicious mushroom. Throw it on the grill, slice it up, fry it up, whatever you want. And down in the bottom right is some sunflowers planted in there. Everything I planted a little like colonized chunk of wood into the peat mixture and soil mixture and compost mixture to let mushrooms grow. And you can see down here this little bright pink little fungus growing out. I mean, as soon as we planted these wood chips, and these were fresh aspen wood chips, all of a sudden we had probably like 5 or 6 different ascomycetes, things that are like cup fungi growing out of the ground that we never put in there. Just like, I was like, sweet, they're decomposers. They're just breaking this stuff down. These logs, you can see the little dots along the way. That's aspen drilled, and it's got stuff, massive blooms, like a half a basketball, like coming out of the ground of just oyster mushrooms every year after a good rain.
I just found a false morel in with my tomatoes where we put the wood chips in, and that came out of the wood chips. I said,
"Yep."
Is that
ascomycete? You won't want to eat it. It's
poisonous. No, right. But it'll break down.
Definitely breaking stuff down.
Cool.
Definitely breaking stuff down. You'll see things like other kind of little wood-eating fungi. When we were at the Saprobes, mycorrhizae, and parasites page, there was like that little clump of mushrooms in the background eating, and that was like out like just a couple feet from that thing there. We didn't plant any of those things. We put Stropharia in there, and we put oyster mushrooms, all this other stuff came up that we'd never even thought about. So, and then that top one up there, that's a garden. I expanded the garden and worked with a lot of different types of mycelium just to kind of get it into that part of the landscape. This is the backyard, it's the north face, it's in the shadow of the house. It's kind of got some fruit trees that we put in there, and we just wanted to like help this landscape out. There's a lot of stuff in there. So think about it, like that garden was primarily just bulbs, okay? So iris bulbs, there were tulips and different things like that. And those things put off a lot of dead material every year. The outside has those dry husks and stuff. And it was just eating that stuff up. It was eating the straw that I put in there for mulch. It was eating the compost and stuff. So there's a lot of stuff happening. It was beneficial. You could see that the whole garden rebounded once we started doing that. And we weren't watering. We're just letting the natural cycles do it. And the mulches and the mushrooms and everything are making it work. All right, let's go on. So this project up in the mountains is pretty good. So that other one was a desert landscape, right? South facing, like just the challenges you face in a desert make your attention to detail all the more important in the whole system and how it plays out. And I've been harvesting from that environment, like for projects. The landowner has changed and happens to be an old boss of mine now, so it's just kind of a cool thing. I'm using that material every year. It's been growing there, naturalizing to the Placerville environment for, 6 years now? 5, 6 years now. So it's growing, it's healthy. I'm able to take stuff from it every year and give it more wood chips every year. As long as you're feeding it, it'll keep producing some food. This one, the town of Telluride decided they needed a better water strategy. They start collecting from the upper basins. They're bringing water into this building. It's 70 by 100 feet. That's 7,000 square feet, right? One half of it, I've got planted over here that way with mushroom mycelium and 8-inch layer of wood chips. The top layer of their soils that they put in there, which is just, you know, alpine soil is nothing. There's no soil. It's decomposed telluride conglomerate layer. It's a bunch of chunks of things that have fallen down the hillsides and off the cliffs from avalanches and tree falls and erosion. So there's really nothing there that's good. And we mixed in, and there's like an 18-inch layer of stuff on top of an 18-inch layer of concrete. So I'm working with this much. The top layer is mixed with aspen wood chips. On top of that, we've got this pure wood chip layer with mushrooms that I've put in there. So this project is an example, not only of like alpine, but it's an example of how a community can come together to put a project together. So
is there a problem you're looking to solve?
So they want it to be a naturalized space, but they don't want trees. And I was like, I want hookah culture in here because then I can grow it out on this, and trap some water in there, and I'll have like stuff that can grow. No, we don't want trees up there. Can't do this. This is town telluride. I'm like, okay, well then, what can I do? They're like, well, you can put wood chips up there. And I'm
it's 12:30. Like, well, just let you know.
What's that?
It's 12:30.
Okay.
Just let you know.
So basically this project, they wanted to put native wildflowers and wildflower seed in there. And I said, well, I've done this down in the Placerville project. Maybe we can try it a couple thousand feet higher. And this is over 9,000. So, you know, some friends of mine in the town of Telluride said, let's just see what we can do. And so we hauled, this is my friend Travis. He's a strong dude. He and I took several truckloads. We're talking like big arborist truckloads of wood chips dumped. We carried tarps up the slope on that side over near friend over there. Come up and around and then dumped them and did this for days. And then we carried up the mushroom mycelium in these big, huge coffee bags. I felt like, what will this? And carried these big things up and then dumped them in there and it grew. Let's go to the next slide. All right, top right. Too bad Horton just left, but that's Horton right there. He's out here. I worked with Buckhorn Gardens. We grew out mushroom mycelium in the front of their wallapini, which was the coldest part of the wallapini because that wall faces north in the front. And we grew it out. This is a pile of it growing out inside these big coffee bags here. Grown on a mixture of cocoa coir from Delilah's grow op in Telluride, mixed with some coffee chafe from the roasters up there. Nick and Doug gave me a bunch of stuff. Those white containers came from the ice cream store up there. The big barrel came from Mary Jane's Medicinals. And the leaves came from people all over the Kelowna and Montrose area. The wood chips came from one of the arborists I worked for in Telluride. So we're bringing community together with the byproducts of industry. We're growing it all together, and then we're going to haul it up. Let's look at the next one. They use machines on top of that roof. That's how thick the roof is. They mix that stuff in because it was totally frozen solid and not anything I could do. They mix it in. Then I carried up those products at Columbia Bags. We carried up all the mushroom mycelium. This little toy here is a thermal hygrometer. Basically touches the temperature and the humidity. And we water. Tons of water. So, and the alpine is a lot like a desert. It dries out really fast. And it's got the same problems and stuff. The sun's more intense, and mycelium's not going to grow on the surface in these places. So, it's going down. I'm in this other picture on the bottom right, I'm actually pouring out buckets of myceliated material and just sprinkling it on the ground. Hundreds of pounds of it. All right. So there you have it. That project, I busted my ass on that project. I broke my back on that project. I grew out my psyllium for months, okay? And that little dot right there is what I did in a landscape that's so affected by mining, that's so affected by runoff. Look at these toxic pools that glow right there. Okay? I'm not even touching those yet. And that's just an acre. I'm only on 3,500 square feet of space.
This right here is the old Superfund site right above Terra.
That's the one. That's that place that before it was capped was causing heavy metal contamination in the children in that town. Okay? Every doctor for 100 miles that the people took their kids to were seeing this in their kids. So I feel compelled at the top of the Colorado River watershed to offer the best water to the people of California, right? I mean, that's our job. And that right there is what's representative of just one guy and a couple helpers trying to make it happen, you know? It's a lot of work, but we can do it if we all kind of come together and make it happen, you know? It's a lot of effort, it's a lot of understanding, it's a lot of compassion. It's empathy for the natural environment around you. It's that relationship that only comes from knowing and understanding and feeling compelled to do it, because nobody's going to tell you to do it, right? You have to do it on your own. There's no law that says protect the environment. There's not anything like that. You don't go to jail for protecting the environment unless you're actually doing it, right? Otherwise, they tend to just let. All right, so let's turn to the next page. We're just going to finish this up a little bit. So what can you do with mushrooms? What can you do yourself? You can take them home and grow them. You can make your own medicine. You can share everything you learned today with somebody else so that you can take that knowledge and get more people to know this. This isn't an industry that needs to be privatized. Mushrooms need to be publicized, right? Everybody needs a piece of the action. Otherwise, it's not going to start changing the soils on a grander scale. It's not going to start remediating the effects of what we're doing on a landscape. And we can't understand it unless we do it ourselves and then share that knowledge. So this gives us a good foundation today, right? We're going to, later, there's another presentation, says mycology on there. It's the application of this knowledge to install a mushroom piece in this landscape so that they can take that stuff right there and spread it here, and we can spread it to the next permaculture convergence. Because this contains some material from the last permaculture convergence at Grant's house. So, two things. One is, you can hit the next slide. I just want to thank Rayne for doing some recording of this. She's got a documentary called Can Mushrooms Save the Planet? It's a novel idea, right? Or a video idea, not novel, but maybe you can write it. She's just doing this on her own. She's got compassion and empathy for the environment, the people around her, and she wants to bring this to people. She's not the expert. I'm not the expert. We're all learning, you know, as we go through this. We need everybody's opinions and understandings to kind of bring a better understanding of how we can bring this to people, you know? You can hit, like, the next one real quick. It's my thing. And then the next one is a way you can contact me.
And do you sell mycelium?
I do sell mycelium. I sell this mycelium. I sell other types of mycelium. I have a bunch of different products that I do. Right now,
do you mail them?
I can mail them. Yeah, it's wise to do during certain times of the year, and other times it's better to personally bring in.
And so, if I wanted to inoculate my garden, what would I do?
Come to this presentation in a couple hours. you would just basically take some of this material, you would bury it in the ground, and under 4 to 6 to 8 inches of mulch, you know, the best place is under a shady tree. and water it, get it all nice and friendly, and then just let go. Water it every time you go in there and feel like it's dry or something.
Are you familiar or know anyone that has done it? I've tried to use oysters is what I was, the idea was pitched to me as, but using mushrooms and gray water treatment?
Yeah,
like a gray water cell?
Absolutely. So I went to the first, the second radical mycology convergence. It was up in Northwest. It was outside of Port Townsend, Washington. And the entire camp, so everybody camped just like this situation on some new property, but there's, wonderful tall trees and just lush, dripping environment. Every place that we were going to the bathroom, so people peed into a veil, or people like were washing the dishes, and the gray water went out into a bed of either straw or wood chips or something that was inoculated, and that acted as a filter. So these filters, microfilters, are pretty amazing things, what you can do with them. You can take wood chips, grow out mushroom mycelium on it, like wood chips, a little bit of sawdust, whatever, pour water into it, whoop, drink it out the other side. It's really amazing what microfilters can do, and you can address a lot of things. Oyster mushrooms are, you gotta kind of train them, get them up to speed on what they're gonna have to address in that environment. If you know what chemicals you're using in your house, like for soaps, let's say, you can use those and train something so that it can eat just that thing. I mean, that's what I do in the laboratory, is kind of do these little torture tests where this little petri dish has like 5%, this one has 20%. Watch what this does.
Yeah.
And they're teachable.
You teach them, yeah. They're very, very good at learning and training them up to a certain thing. So,
is there a type you recommend more than oyster if I were to try doing it?
I think oyster's a good one, yeah.
Also,
oyster's a really easy one.
Strafaria work too?
Strafaria works pretty good. Strafaria is better because of the bacteria situation. It can deal with bacteria really well, and it actually accelerates growth in some situations.
How do you spell that?
Strafaria?
Yeah.
Stropharia.
Cool. I had another question too. Two actually. One is, do mushrooms actually need a certain amount of light, or could they work in complete darkness?
Well, okay, so here's the thing. The mycelium can grow through the substrates. It grows, and it doesn't need any light. So you can have the medicinal components from that part of it, right? Just from the mycelium, and not ever have to food it. Not everything works that way, but for the most part, it does. The only time you really need light is for fruiting the mushroom.
Okay.
That's really where it comes out. Some of them need a lot of light. Some of them just need just the little bit of light. A morel grown in a container in a lighted area will grow up and turn towards the light, right? Oyster mushrooms growing in a lighted room will just come out and do their shelfy thing. They don't like turn and go over here to go find it. They somewhat do that, but
So, to never give it like direct light would be okay.
Direct light
completely
works.
Sure. Well, I'm wondering, because if I'm going to do this gray water cell before everything comes into the botanical cell, so this one I don't want my glass cell facing like my botanical cell.
Well, having light on the top will reduce some of the competitors like mold. Having light on the surface of it will reduce bacteria contamination and issues that happen from low light situations.
Okay.
So when a good application of this, when I grow mushrooms, like in this situation, you do want to have the sun on them because it does reduce some of the other issues that can arise from not having light on it, and then you have mold grow in a dark space, or you have black molds grow around the edge, or whatever. So, of a container that's plastic, or whatever.
Right.
So there's definitely ways to do it, but we could talk more about it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Also, easy one. Is cypress mulch similar to like pines, or is it?
It's more like juniper.
Right. I'm wondering, is that
Yeah, I wouldn't really
go with that.
I've tested a few things like that and not had success. Okay. Just because somebody said you couldn't do it, and I was like, well, I'm gonna do it. And I was like, okay. He was right.
So, what you would recommend is an optimum mix of this Excelsior already to be sawdust and the masonry makers would be good.
Yeah, I'd say like 1 to 10, but you have to, like,
mix it,
break those clumps up. Because the first time they said, hey, there's free stuff, I went over there and drove up with a truck, and I was like, I want a whole truckload of this. And then I saw it, and I was like, ooh.
1 part fines to 10 parts chips?
Something like that.
Or straw?
Straw and chips. I mean, the more mix you give it, the more resilient it's going to be when it runs into something else that it wants to eat. It'll know how to eat grass. It'll know how to eat wood chips. And it'll kind of move through those things. And some of it needs a food that's easy to eat, right? Like a little tiny piece of sawdust, you know, is a little quick piece of energy. It's like eating a power bar. A big wood chip is like eating off a half a cow for, you know, your family, right? So it just like stores energy, it protects it, things like that. There's another way to do this. You can use biochar, and they're producing biochar at the Excelsior plant now too. Yeah, it's a big question mark because it sends a big, huge plume of smoke through the town, and it just, they get all these calls and stuff, big fire going on, which is what's happening. But so they're doing this biochar thing. The cool thing about biochar is that it allows other fungi and things to be protected from bacteria that might go in and try to compete with it, and from little nematodes and things that might want to compete with it. Because the char has these little sharp edges. Think about soft-bodied things. They don't like to be scratched. I mean, we do. We do here and there, right? But, you know, like, soft-bodied things, they really like to go through soft things, you know? I mean, worms eat wood chips and things like that, but that biochar protects it. Especially mycorrhizal, like arbuscular mycorrhizae, or things that we find in the soils that, like, are benefiting the grasses and things around us here, you know? Biochar could be a really good one to start with. And I usually throw some kind of charcoal into my liquid inoculants. So if I take like a, so here's what I do. I go pick a morel mushroom, take one of the old ones that I had, it's kind of dried up, I chuck it in the blender and turn it into a bunch of little tiny pieces, and then I throw it in the bottom of a bucket, and then I throw in some molasses, and I pour in some salt, and then I pour in a bunch of water, I put in some ash and some charcoal, and then I put a blender, like a big paddle on my drill bit, and then I put a bubbler in there and let it go. Right? So it has all the energy and nutrients, like molasses is sweet, not just sweet like on your tongue, but it's so good. The molasses has so many nutrients for your plants. If you just fed your plants molasses water, they would still do really amazing. So when you do this for fungi, they love it too. They get that sugar, you just kick them off, the spores that are in there. Yeah, so let them germinate for a couple days, and then pour that out in your yard and see what happens.
What if I don't want to do that?
Okay, so you could use honey if you want. It does. The reason I would use honey is to reduce bacteria competition.
Like antimicrobial, right?
Yeah, totally. Yeah, so you're just trying to kill off other things.
Like agave.
You know, I'm not familiar with how agave works, actually. I haven't heard of its, like, antibiotic or antibacterial qualities. So I don't know. If it does, then that would be sweet. That's something I'm
not familiar with. It is sweet, actually.
If I didn't want to do all that process, when I get spontaneous mushrooms in my yard, I just pick them and throw them in other shady parks. Is that okay too?
Yeah.
Is it better to break them up and toss them?
Sure. Totally. The more spores in your environment, the better chance it has to take off in a different little microbiome.
So when I bring a bleat home and I find out it's wormy, and I put that in my compost. Am I inoculating that compost?
I'd first take off the pores under it and dry those and use that for soup flavoring and thickener. And then I would take the other part of it and dry it and turn it into a powder and add salt to it, so I have porcini salt.
No, but I'm talking about the ones that the worms have gotten.
Yeah, they're so bad. Yeah, I would cut off the top and just lay it on the ground, face down.
Face down.
Under a spruce tree. On your property,
yeah, that's
I would put it under a pine, a pinion. Yeah, that would be the best thing for it. It's going to be dry, but let's say, because each one of those pinion trees has its little host community, right?
Right.
And it has the real thick needle duff bed in there. If you peel that back, wet it down, and put that on there, and then put that stuff over the top, see what happens. Maybe a coyote will come and dig it up later, but.
What about ponderosa needles?
Ponderosa needles are nice. They're going to, you know, there's a. You can definitely go get some mushrooms in the Pondy Belt and get them going in your ponderosa needles. You can still do that. Are you still over in Bayville? So you could, that area would work. I actually like that back 40 area, you know, like that whole area and any of that Pondy area there. You could get stuff growing in those needle beds. It would be about the same kind of situation. The leads aren't really going to take off in that situation. They're mycelium light, but they're not likely to fruit because the growth parameters are so narrow, even in the alpine environment. You know,
like slippery jacks. They're more dry.
Right? Yeah, you could totally. And you could just apply that same principle out on any mushroom that you really want to grow. And then wait and see what happens, you know. Check it, because the... You come back sometime, you'll see like this big pile of dried mushrooms. You're like, oh, I missed it. There was like 3 pounds there. That was enough for a good dinner. Yeah.
Have you heard of people chopping up hemp or cannabis stalks and using that as a substrate?
Yeah, totally. And it works really well because that fiber is a really, anything like that, that's such a good fiber for making clothes and making things, is perfect. So the marijuana industry, any bales of that stuff you can get together and like use, go for it. The biggest the thing about the marijuana industry right now is that they're trying to, a lot of people are kind of scared to do that with their stuff, but if you're working with a dispensary that's got like laws, they have to measure every dang gram of stock and stem and leaf and everything, whether they're useful or not. But that's a good thing to use, and it's a highly underused thing right now. So trying to establish something that for waste products is probably a good direction to go if you're interested in mushrooms and affecting change in the marijuana industry. That would be something.
Would it be taking those stalks and mulching them out, like running through a chipper? Would that help to increase surface area and
totally.
Lanes?
Yep. Even having that kind of matrix in with wood chips, like laying those stalks in with the wood chips, allows it to run the length of the stem, gives it a good opportunity for moving through a landscape.
Do you need to be careful of what they spray their plants with?
Well, I don't like marijuana that has been used with chemicals like that. Mm-hmm. So they shouldn't even use it. There are some fungi that actually break down some of those chemicals. And there are some books specifically that talk about those chemicals, right? They're expensive books because when you do a run of myco-remediation books in a nation of maybe 1,000 people that do that or are testing it, not people actually doing it, but are just interested, you still have to do a big book run, and the books cost like $200 a piece, or $250 sometimes.
So, have a library.
Yeah.
Excuse me, in an arid climate, wouldn't a swale be the ultimate place because you're developing a body of moisture underneath it?
Yep, totally. Like this swale right here, the how it's built up, like the whole architecture with the chunks, those rounds and things, and the logs and things that are in there. And then if you were to weave in some, that's why we're going to use some of the Excelsior material. Weave that into there. Once that water's in there and you have enough moisture and it's wicking up through that homoculture idea, like it just, it's got what it needs.
Yeah.
It will find its way to the surface if it likes it to fruit because it wants to reproduce once it's got enough of its own situation going on. So we're talking about temperature. We're talking about relative humidity and soil moisture. We're talking about airflow, which doesn't really come into play in this situation. Light. I mean, it's going to look for the light in that situation and then pop up and stuff, which then is a food source.
What is the proper way to harvest a wild mushroom to reduce the impact of the pollen?
The least amount of impact is to cut it right at the surface of the ground.
Right at the ground.
Yeah. That avoids all the argumentative stuff of pulling it out of the ground. Which some people, I could see the argument. If you pull it out of the ground, basically a mushroom has to compete against the viruses and bacteria that are then put into the mycelium right there. If you cover it back up with its native dirt and stuff, it'll go back to having less competitors in the system. But let's say you had an illness, like some nasty virus, and you pull that mushroom out of the ground and you cough in there, right? It has to compete with that virus. It has to learn how to compete with it. So, the lowest impact is to cut it off right at the ground. You don't necessarily have to do that, but
a lot less clean.
A lot less clean.
I just wanted to point out, it shows on the schedule that we're meeting over at the patio. Is that where everybody's meeting and then walking up to the installation point? Or
how many people here are interested in doing this?